Please join me with our call to worship found in your bulletin this morning, taken from Psalm 50. The Mighty One, God our Redeemer, speaks and summons the earth from the rising of the sun to its setting. Our God comes and does not keep silence. Before God is a devouring fire. Round about God a raging storm.
God calls to heavens above and the earth to the people's cry.
Gather to God the faithful ones who made a covenant with God by sacrifice. Those who bring praise as their sacrifice honor God. To those who order their way aright, God will show salvation. And now please join me in the Apostles' Creed, found at number 881 in your hymnal. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Our first hymn this morning is in the little black book. Number 2173, Shine, Jesus, Shine. If it's comfortable for you to do so, please stand and please sing.
Thank you.
Loving Creator, we give you thanks for this day, this bright and shining day, when we pause to remember that Jesus shone on the mountain, shone with your glory and your love. And God, we give thanks again for all of those who were a part of Night to Shine on Friday. God, we thank you for the opportunity to tell the world that you love each of us and that you have a special love for those who bear burdens. God, we ask that the burden lightening that came on that shining night would remain in the hearts of the guests and their caregivers and the volunteers, not just for that one night, but for days and weeks and months to come. And that when they think of that night, that they would remember how much you love them. Oh God, we do, as Jesus taught us to, good deeds for your glory. For your glory, not for our own. So, God, we ask that your glory would continue to shine for those who were blessed. God, we remember this morning those who grieve. We remember those who are sick. We remember those who are recovering. We remember those who struggle with modern demons of addiction. We remember, God, those who are without shelter or proper clothing. God, we pray that your Spirit would so move in us and in our community that people would be helped. People would be saved. God, help us all to turn to you through Jesus, our Lord and Savior. Help us, O God, to walk in his footsteps, to incorporate his teaching into our lives. Help us, O God, to shine like the candles on the hill. All for your glory. Loving Creator, we thank you for your love. We thank you for Jesus. We thank you that he taught us to come to you in prayer as to a beloved parent, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Our next hymn this morning, number 189, Fairest Lord Jesus. Please stand if you're able and please sing.
Thank you.
remain standing for the doxology. If you're able, please remain standing for the reading of the gospel this morning, coming from the gospel according to Mark chapter 9, verses 2 through 9. 6 days later, Jesus took with him Peter and James and John and led them up a high mountain apart by themselves. And he was transfigured before them, and his clothes became dazzling white, such as no one on earth could bleach them. And there appeared to them Elijah with Moses, who were talking with Jesus. Then Peter said to Jesus, "Rabbi, it is good for us to be here. Let us make three dwellings, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." He did not know what to say, for they were terrified. Then a cloud overshadowed them, and from the cloud there came a voice, "This is my son, the beloved. Listen to him." Suddenly, when they looked around, they saw no one with them anymore, but only Jesus. As they were coming down the mountain, he ordered them not to tell no one about what they had seen until after the Son of Man had risen from the dead. For the word of God in Scripture, for the word of God among us, for the word of God within us. Thanks be to God. Amen. Jan asked me before the service, since this was the Sunday that we'd originally planned to go to Antioch Baptist Church, if I was going to preach the same sermon that I would have preached at Antioch. And I said, well, sorta. I've trimmed it down a good bit because in the black church, if I don't preach for at least 30 to 40 minutes, they feel shortchanged. And somehow I didn't think y'all were ready for that this morning. So this is the expurgated version. But today is Transfiguration Sunday, which is the last Sunday in the liturgical season of Epiphany, and this coming Wednesday, as previously noted, is Ash Wednesday, the beginning of Lent. Everybody break out your purple, and I encourage everyone to participate in the Ash Wednesday service at First United Methodist. Next Sunday, we'll begin our look at Jesus' preparation and at ours for the great central drama of salvation, Jesus' death on the cross and his resurrection on Easter morning. But Jesus has already begun to prepare his disciples for the end prior to the transfiguration. That's what Mark referred to when he begins this story 6 days later. Anybody remember what happened 6 days earlier? Well, don't worry, I'm going to tell you. 6 days prior to this mountaintop story, Jesus had asked his disciples, "Who do you say that I am?" And Peter had answered, "You are the Messiah." And Peter got the gold star for that answer, but almost immediately went from the penthouse to the doghouse by arguing with Jesus about how Jesus saw the remainder of his ministry playing out. Because for the first time, Jesus has told them that he will suffer and be rejected and be killed and rise from the dead. Not only that, he tells them, but anyone who wants to follow him will have to take up a cross and lose their life for his sake. Pretty sobering stuff. No wonder Peter didn't like it much. Although Jesus does seem to soften all the bad news by promising that some of them will not taste death before they see the kingdom of God coming with power. So, 6 days later, Jesus takes the three disciples who have become his inner circle, Peter, James, and John, and heads up a mountain. And when they get to where they're going, a miracle happens. It's a pretty impressive miracle, just reading Mark's stripped-down story cold. But even more so, if we take some time to look at some of the details that would have seemed obvious to the three disciples and to Mark and to his readers, but maybe not so much to us in 21st century Missouri. So first of all, what's the significance of Mark's description of Jesus' metamorphosis? There's something here besides Jesus' robe becoming whiter than white. The fabric of pure white, which was almost impossible to attain at that time, and the bright light would have been inseparably linked in the disciples' minds with the presence of God. Encountering this phenomenon on a mountaintop, they would have immediately thought of Moses, who went up to the mountain to receive the law from God and came back, Exodus tells us, with his face shining so brightly that people were afraid, and he had to wear a veil whenever he came back from the presence of the Lord. Since Jesus habitually referred to himself as the Son of Man, the disciples may also have been put in mind of the vision of Daniel. I looked, and thrones were set in place, and the Ancient of Days took his seat. His clothing was white as snow, and there before me was one like a Son of Man coming with the clouds of heaven. Peter, James, and John have a vision of Jesus surrounded by the power of God, not unlike Paul's vision of brightness on the Damascus Road, or the way that Paul later writes to Timothy that God dwells in unapproachable light. As if this sudden and dramatic change in their friend's appearance wasn't enough to unnerve the apostles, he's suddenly joined by two figures whom mysteriously they find they recognize immediately, Moses and Elijah. Certainly, we recognize these names as two of the great heroes of the Hebrew Scriptures, but we might ask, why these two? Perhaps in a foreshadowing of Jesus' resurrection, it is because these two have their own peculiar relationship to death. Elijah, after all, never died, the Scriptures say, but was swept living off to heaven in a fiery chariot. First century Judaism also questioned whether Moses had died. The Scriptures, after all, said that God had buried him. Could it mean that he too had been assumed bodily into heaven? Moses and Elijah would have also been, for the disciples, the very embodiment of the Scriptures, the law represented by Moses and the prophets represented by Elijah. Although Mark does not quote Jesus as Matthew does, saying that he is come to fulfill the law and the prophets, the image of Moses and Elijah in conversation with Jesus could certainly elicit that same meaning. There would have been an even more immediate connection for the disciples between their master and these two great prophets. Throughout their time together, Jesus has been pointing them toward the kingdom of God. His very first recorded words in Mark's gospel are, "The time is fulfilled and the kingdom of God is at hand." Just 6 days before, remember, he's told them that some of them will not taste death until they see the kingdom of God come with power. As good Jews, they would have known the promises of Scripture regarding that fulfillment. The words of Moses in Deuteronomy 18:15, "The Lord your God will raise up for you a prophet like me from among your own brothers. You must listen to him." And the prophet of God through the promise of God through the prophet Malachi, "See, I will send you Elijah, the man of God, before the day of the Lord comes. That's why the disciples reported to Jesus that some people thought Jesus was Elijah. Those folks were on to something, but Jesus wasn't Elijah. He was the embodiment of the kingdom of God itself. It's all just too much for Peter, and he starts babbling. Thank God for Peter. I mean, really, bless his heart. If there's a thing to be done the wrong way around, Peter will find it. He charges in where he should wait, equivocates when he should be sure, and generally flaps his jaw at the most inappropriate times. Peter always comforts me greatly, because if a screw-up like him can get the keys to heaven, I figure there's maybe a little place for me somewhere too. Anyway, church tradition tells us that Mark based his gospel on stories that he heard from Peter. And I think it's greatly to Peter's credit that he told this story to Mark. I mean, can't you just hear him? "Well, young man, to tell you the truth, I was so scared I just started talking." I'm not sure I would have been that coherent in that situation. Peter's enthusiasm, at least, is admirable. He wants to stay in that glorious moment forever. It's a very human response. We love the limelight. Suffering and death, not so high on our lists. Peter wants to build three huts or booths to commemorate the event, just as the Jews celebrated the Feast of Booths by building little huts to recall their time in the wilderness and how God came and dwelt with them or tabernacled among them. John, the one evangelist whose gospel does not tell the story of the transfiguration, picks up on this idea when he writes that the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. Literally, the Word became flesh and pitched his tent with us. Pitched his tent comes from the same root in Greek as the word Mark uses here for what Peter wants to build, the little booths. The little huts, tabernacles. Peter's babbling is halted by yet another phenomenon. A cloud billows up, again, a sure sign of the presence of God. God appeared in a cloud by day to lead the Israelites across the desert. God appeared to Moses in a cloud on Sinai. Mark says that they were overshadowed by the cloud, the same word used in Gabriel's annunciation to Mary in Luke's gospel when he tells her how to expect the presence of God. The Holy Spirit will overshadow you. Jesus later foretells his own return surrounded by the clouds of heaven, and Paul reminds the Christians in Thessalonica of that promise. Lots of stuff in the New Testament. And if there is any doubt about what the appearance of the cloud means, the voice of God is heard with nearly the same words as at Jesus' baptism. "This is my beloved Son. Listen to him." If the disciples were frightened before, I would imagine they were absolutely terrified now. Mark writes, "And suddenly when they had looked around, they no longer saw anyone with them except Jesus." God has reminded the three apostles that the one who has proclaimed himself as the Son of Man is also the Son of God, and they are to listen to him, even if they don't particularly care for what he is saying. So, they pick themselves up and dust themselves off and trudge off down the mountainside with Jesus to start all over again. Larry, that sounds like a song. Some of y'all got it. They're not allowed to hang out on the mountaintop, basking in the experience. Jesus has things to do, places to go, people to see. On the way back to the others, he once again tells them to keep the miracle to themselves. He is still not ready for the messianic secret to be revealed. He doesn't want people to follow him for the wrong reason. If the disciples tell this story now, it will sound like the coronation of a political Messiah, and that's not who Jesus is. Jesus knows that to truly fulfill his mission of inaugurating the kingdom of God, of helping people to hear the good news to the poor, and to experience release from spiritual prisons and healing of spiritual blindness, he's going to have to die and be resurrected. Only once that is accomplished can this story be told and understood. Only when seen through the lens of the empty tomb will this vision be able to have its full meaning. So, now that we know the whole story, what is the meaning of the transfiguration for us? What can we take away from this particular tale? Perhaps one answer is that we're sometimes in so much of a hurry to make Jesus, and therefore God, accessible to a modern audience that we minimize the awe that we should feel in being confronted with the living God. We inadvertently try to tame and domesticate the power of God so that modern folk are not put off by the outlandishness of God's power. But to try to capture the whole story of salvation, we've got to start dealing in the realm of miracles and manifestations of the divine. In his book, Wishful Thinking, the great theologian Frederick Buechner writes, "Mysticism is where religions start. Religion as ethics, institution, dogma, ritual, scripture, social action, all of this comes later, and in the long run, probably counts for less. Religions start, as Frost said poems do, with a lump in the throat, to put it mildly, or with a bush going up in flames, a rain of flowers, a dove coming out of the sky." Another writer I admire, Annie Dillard, puts it even more bluntly in her book, Teaching a Stone to Talk. Listen to what Annie Dillard writes. "Does anyone have the foggiest idea of what sort of power we so blithely invoke in church? Or, as I suspect, does no one believe a word of it? The churches are children playing on the floor with their chemistry sets, mixing up a batch of TNT to kill a Sunday morning. It is madness to wear ladies' straw hats and velvet hats to church. We should all be wearing crash helmets. Ushers should issue life preservers and signal flares. They should lash us to our pews. For the sleeping God may awake someday and take offense, or the waking God may draw us to where we can never return." And Madeleine L'Engle, famous for her disguised theology in the book A Wrinkle in Time — I'm not spoiling that book for anybody, am I, to know that it's theology? Madeleine L'Engle wrote, "Would the angels cry out, 'Fear not,' if there was nothing to frighten us?" Friends, we serve an awesome God, and I mean that in the truest sense of the word awesome, rather than the watered-down version in use today. We Christians must live in the paradox of a God who knows us to the very number of hairs on our heads and loves us enough to give up everything but love for us, and yet who has the power to create the cosmos, or to destroy it. Again, from Madeleine L'Engle, "This is strong stuff, mythic stuff, that stuff which makes life worth living, which lies on the other side of provable fact. How can we be Christians without understanding this? The incarnation itself bursts out of the bounds of reason. That the power which created all of the galaxies, all of the stars in all of their courses, should willingly limit that power in order to be one of us, and all for love of us. That cannot be understood in terms of laboratory proof, but only in terms of love." When we take the story of the Transfiguration seriously, we come face to face with that living, dangerous, loving God. The story of the Transfiguration also fulfills Jesus' promise to the disciples and to us that the kingdom of God has begun. It arrived in power at the Transfiguration, as he suggested it would 6 days before the journey up the mountain. As Luke records Jesus saying, "The kingdom of God is within us," or perhaps a better translation, "The kingdom of God is among us." The kingdom of God, as Jesus taught, is both now and not yet, inaugurated but not fulfilled. We who follow Jesus, who take his example as our model, and who live our lives, as Paul so often said, in Christ, we are citizens of that kingdom of God. The kingdom is not yet fulfilled, but it will be. And until the time it is fulfilled, we, God's ambassadors to the world, we are called to offer God's peace to all we encounter, to spread the good news of healing and restoration. Like Peter, we can't stay on the mountaintop much as we might like to. Our experience of our awesome God and the transfigured Christ carries with it a call to action. Remember the voice. "This is my beloved Son. Listen to him." And remember what Jesus has just said to his disciples. "Anyone who wishes to be a follower of mine must leave self behind. They must take up their cross and come with me. Whoever cares for their own safety is lost, but if someone will let themselves be lost for my sake and for the good news, that one is safe." There is dirty, dangerous work to be done, spreading the word of peace where there is war, reaching out hands of healing and love to those who struggle with modern demons of mental instability or addiction, visiting the poor and the prisoners. Jesus knew what we would have to face. He did it himself. On the day before he was assassinated, Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. said this, "I have been to the mountaintop. I just want to do God's will. God has allowed me to go up to the mountain, and I've looked over, and I've seen the promised land, so I'm happy tonight. I'm not worried about anything. I'm not fearing anyone, for my eyes have seen the glory of the coming of the Lord." That's what Peter, James, and John saw up on that mountaintop. The glory of the coming of the Lord. We have work to do down here in the valley. We will find the strength to do it through the Spirit of the Lord, Jesus, whose love sustains us always. Like the apostles, like Dr. King, like countless Christians before us, we can take courage from knowing that we are within the kingdom of God, and the kingdom of God is within us. Let us go forth from this place today with the vision of the transfigured Jesus before us, serving humanity, standing for the truth, and following God's holy way. Thanks be to God. Final hymn this morning, number 2103 in the Black Book, "We Have Come at Christ's Own Bidding." I think you'll know the hymn, even if the words are not immediately to your recollection. Please stand and let's sing. Thank you. And so, my sisters and my brothers, have no anxiety about anything, but in everything, through prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known unto God, and the peace of God that passes all understanding will keep your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Amen.